Now, it's now my honor to introduce Mr. Singh to give the opening address for this conference. Mr. Singh is an entrepreneur and former politician in Singapore Parliament. He chairs the NTU Board of Trustees Enterprise Committee, and in that capacity, he was instrumental in building up the NTU Innovation and Enterprise ecosystem. He holds an honors degree in engineering from NTU and an MBA from the University of Strathclyde. Among many other things, Mr. Singh is known for his strong conviction that one must always speak the truth, and for his compassion to a fair society. Disruptions are a threat to both fairness and the quality of life of all citizens, so we felt it would be very fitting to invite Mr. Singh to open this conference. And of course, we are very pleased and honored when he accepted our invitation. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Inderjit Singh.
Very good morning, Jan Vasbinder, Tony Myers, European representative at NTU, distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you for inviting me to this conference and for inviting me to deliver the opening address. I'm honored and humbled by this. I would like to congratulate NTU and commend Jan and also Tony and also Paralimas program for organizing this important conference, especially at a time when the world is facing greater uncertainties, which increases our exposure to risk. Because of the multidisciplinary nature of risk, its causes and solutions, it's crucial to discuss this at many levels, including from outside the policymakers and government's perspective, which is what Paralimas aim to achieve through this conference. Hence, it's an important initiative that I would like to see become a significant platform and voice for, in this regard. Now, throughout history, the world has been faced by several disruptions, some positive and others less so. From the two world wars to the collapse of the Berlin Wall, and from entering of China into the global economic realm, advent of internet, we have seen how disruptions have affected societies, not just for a few years, but for decades after. And in recent times itself, we have been faced by so many disruptions, arguably more than at any time in history. Itself is a reflection of the rapidly evolving and uncertain world that we live in. Let me focus on some of these and discuss the impact that they have had or will have on society, both in Singapore and also globally. First, nationalism and political disruption. Politically, the last 2 years have seen a lot of change and upheaval. Globally, the rise of nationalism and populism threatens the end of a trend that had been on the rise for the last few decades, and that is of globalization and its accompanying ideology of international political liberalism. Since the collapse of the Berlin Wall and the end of the Cold War, free trade and the dissipation of borders and barriers has made the world more open, a more open space where capital, labor, goods, and services and ideas have moved freely. This had arguably given a boost to capitalism, which in return saw large parts of the world develop and benefit economically and at a societal level. But the recent cases of the Brexit and the US elections have demonstrated that leaders can now pander on populist sentiments, claiming that their respective societies have lost out and not benefited from an open world. And so as a result, we have for the first time, both in UK and US, which have traditionally been the bastions of a free world, now threatening its very existence. And it's not the end yet. Both Italy and France, due for elections, could head the same way. If nationalist governments come into power, for example in Italy, it's likely to also call for a referendum to leave the EU. Now I fear that we may see disintegration of the EU if that happens, certainly sooner than some may expect. And also, as our late Lee Kuan Yew had seen it not succeeding in the past. What has also emerged in this episode is that the truth is now forgotten, a forgotten virtue, as far as politicians are concerned. Politicians, their parties, and campaigns can all spew blatant lies just to support their agendas, and the electorate seem to buy this falsehood without any verifications. Politicians are therefore vindicated for adopting this approach at the ballots, and this could spark off a worrying risk of irresponsible governance and politics disrupting the trust that citizens have in government and politicians. What is the impact of this on society and civil society specifically? As an entrepreneur and a former parliamentarian in an open country like Singapore, and you know, I've always focused on the truth, I'm clear that the benefits of liberalization outweigh nationalism. Many of you will also know that I believe strongly in speaking for something that is fair for society. We must always speak what is true and not only what we think pleases others, whoever those others may be. And at tea, I had a discussion with some of you on the importance of speaking the truth today. Even though the benefits of free trade, capitalism, and liberal international regime do not cascade down evenly to every member of society, there is still a net gain for society. It is important that civil society recognizes these points and continue to champion these causes, preventing against a closed world. By definition, civil society is designed to act in the interests of society, and therefore, it should do what it can to educate the masses about the benefits of maintaining an open and external viewpoint and not be too inward-looking. In an environment of lying and nationalist leaders, civil society may also face pressures to their own existence. I would not be surprised if some of these leaders employ similar unscrupulous tactics to suppress civil society groups and movements. Therefore, it is important that they maintain a clear and objective voice and find ways to fight against such nationalist environments. Now, technology and economic disruption. While it's important to maintain the current global economic order, I acknowledge that there have been enough disruptions in the current brand of capitalism to perhaps warrant a rethink on our economic approaches. From the collapse of Lehman Brothers and the global financial crisis to the glut of the oil supply due to OPEC's decisions, which has caused oil prices to crash in sectors and many markets to decline, currency sliding, current models may need to change. This is where another disruptor, technology, will play a key role. We have already seen how technology has changed businesses and disrupted huge industries, from Amazon to Uber to Expedia to Airbnb. But there is much more to come. If adoption is smooth and there are no barriers or hiccups, it is a matter of time before robots and automation replace jobs. We are already seeing this in some way. And this could happen in a big way in the future, much wider than the piecemeal examples that we have been seeing right now. What does it mean economically? For one, we may see our goods and services made so efficiently that it reduces the cost of production so significantly to negligible. This then negates the need for people to earn an income, and so the loss of jobs may not be as hard-hitting. But that, of course, is an utopian world. Reality may well be that the pace of adoption of technology is not as smooth and rapid, and so the intended economies of scale may not be felt so widely. But jobs will still be lost, and we must see how new jobs can be created. Certainly here in Singapore, the government has obviously already recognized this for a few years now, many years in fact, and that is why we have initiatives like Skills Future, designed to train the workforce for new jobs, new careers. But that is contingent upon new industries and new jobs being created in the first place. In this case, I suspect that not all the answers will be with the government. That is why we need more entrepreneurs, not just the ones doing regular brick and mortar businesses, but ones that will build new and innovative companies that can help create the jobs for the future. A major problem with this is risk-taking. As a society in Singapore, we are still not so geared towards taking risks, as we have seen in many places like the Silicon Valley. Maybe the economic slump may create some entrepreneurs this round, but society as a whole needs to change its mindset about risk-taking. And it's important that this is so that we may all have a problem, so that we may well have a problem of unemployment and create social problems if we do not do it. Pressure points and societal disruption. Social and economic instability may lead to other issues that could expose and deepen cracks in our society. It is no secret that when segments of society are left behind and when inequality widens, it's fodder for undesirable elements of society to prey on. Around the world, terrorist groups have adopted this strategy to recruit members, and there is no reason why extremism may not adopt the same approach here in Singapore, should the conditions favour it to do so. Here again, technology has played a key role and has enabled other disruptors to increase the velocity of its impact. Let's look at the examples which could have created consequences on Singapore's social compact. For one, while technology has been a boon to Singapore in many ways, it has also made the world a much smaller place, thus helping global extremist elements to radicalize members of our society, as is happening in all societies around the world. We have seen in recent years, for example, how terrorist networks like ISIS and JI have radicalized Singaporeans to join their fight in Syria and to take up missions against their own country, Singapore. This has undoubtedly given rise to Islamophobia within our society, something our senior leaders have also acknowledged. This could majorly disrupt our social fabric and race relations in Singapore, which is a delicate thing. That is why initiatives like SG Secure, launched by the Prime Minister a few months ago, cannot be taken for granted. Should there be a terrorist attack on our home soil, how will our society react? More so, the perpetrators, local. Moreover, should the perpetrators be local, can our society stand together to withstand that possibility? And given what's happening around the world and being in touch with the ground, I've already seen this concern among races of whether, you know, are we living among those who can create this kind of disruptions among us. These are realities which current disruptors have forced us to deal with and think about. The second pressure point is the rise of China, which itself has been a disruption in so many ways. Economically, it has transformed global supply chain networks and restructured other economies. Politically, several commentators have hailed the Chinese model of socialist capitalism as a viable alternative to the Western brand of democracy that the world has been used to. In the international order too, the rise of China threatens to disrupt the stability the region has been used to in the last 30 years, fueling growth in the region while also unhinging the rules-based system the world and the region has been used to. Clearly, China's rise will bring along with it a clash of ideologies and ideals from time to time with other participants in the region, including Singapore, as we had seen in recent times. And in this respect, Fu Quang's article yesterday is very timely about the message about how Singapore, any one of us, should be dealing with China. For Singapore, the majority ethnic Chinese, which is a majority ethnic Chinese country, such disagreements could be trickier to manage. And should segments of the Chinese society feel drawn to China and sympathetic to their cause, we may see fragments in our society. Technology through social media and the internet could hasten and deepen these cracks and hence disrupt the social cohesion as a country. Due to this reason, civil society and other actors in Singapore will need to do more to build cohesion and trust among Singaporeans and strengthen our resilience and resolve to stand against and cope with the risks of such disruptions, because disruptors have been a feature of society and are here to stay, arguably in a more prominent and a widespread way. In conclusion, I look forward to hearing from other speakers today as well as the possible on the possible disruptions and ensuing risks that we will need to be mindful of. It promises to be an interesting, engaging, and fruitful discussion, and I wish all of you present here today all the best and a fruitful conference. Thank you.